other two important people in the film was his brother, David Baldwin, whom he always referred to as his protector and the Terminator, because when he get into messy situations, David would be there. The other person that was so important in this film was Jerome Smith, who was a civil rights worker that he met about 12 or 15 years before this film, and they remained friends. And I'm not going to say too much about this, or Alicia and Reggie will kill me. But I do want to say one of the important things, I'm not going to say anything too much, I promise. One of the most important things about Jerome is he was involved when he produced, when he wrote the play Blues for Mr. Charlie, excuse me, I'm asthma. And what happened is he had Jerome as someone who was making sure that everything in Blues for Mr. Charlie, when it came to the civil rights workers, were correct. With that, I will say no more on Blues for Mr. Charlie. Steve is going to discuss Giovanni's Room. What I'm saying is we took themes or plays or books that were controversial, and he fought to have these either published or, as in the case of the play, produced. These were things that were not acceptable at the time. I will now give it up to Steve. These are your glasses? I'm sorry. No wonder I didn't see.
Giovanni's Room is Baldwin's second novel, published in 1956. It is his only novel with a white protagonist and all white characters. So you might question, why a novel with no black characters? But after publishing Go Tell on the Mountain, Baldwin was seen by critics and the public at large as being the new black novelist, especially in his treatment of race in America, quite a controversial theme at the time, and his sharing the experience of growing up black in Harlem. Baldwin never liked being made into a type or boxed in with labels. Sure, he was a black writer, but he felt himself much more at the same time. So he set about going to the opposite extreme, a novel with no black and all white characters, and debut with the theme of homosexuality, another taboo subject in America at the time. In this way, for Baldwin, the writing of Giovanni's Room was an act of defiance, as well as being personally liberating. He was able to thwart the expectations that he would be an American black writer per se, while at the same time, in today's terms, outing himself. No other person would now be able to blackmail him for his sexual preferences or sensationalize it. Now he was free to continue writing as he damn well pleased, honestly, and not being limited by others' expectations of what type of writer he was. And indeed, Baldwin's future novels, for the most part, include both black and white characters and a variety of sexual behaviors we might characterize as gay, straight, or bisexual. Why was Baldwin's novel and its treatment of homosexuality so controversial when it happened in 1956? The answer lies in our understanding of American social mores at the time. First, homosexuality in the popular imagination was epitomized by effeminate appearance and behavior among males and masculine appearance and behavior among females. A male homosexual was a fairy, a queer. His sexual partner was referred to as trade or straight, and generally saw himself as heterosexual, especially as he was expected to perform the so-called active role in sex. At the same time, homosexuality was perceived as sinful behavior by religion, a mental disorder by the medical establishment, and a punishable crime. Unprotected by law, a man exposed as a homosexual, picked up, for example, by the police in a bar raid, could risk being fired by his employer, a jail sentence, and loss of his family. It was not rare for gays when thus confronted to take their own lives. In terms of the literary scene, Gore Vidal's novel, The City and the Pillar, published in 1948, stood alone at the time in presenting homosexual characters that did not end up tragically, for this was a pattern in American literature and film whenever the theme appeared. So when Baldwin presented Giovanni's Room for publication, he was advised he may as well burn the book, a novel depicting a romantic relationship between two men, which is too controversial. It would surely alienate his readership, he was told, and probably ruin his career. And though Giovanni's Room was relatively well received by critics when it was published in 1956, there would be continuing critiques of his homosexual writings well into the 70s, the most virulent coming from the self-styled black revolutionary Eldridge Cleaver. The question of Baldwin's personal views of homosexuality are quite enlightening and help us to better understand his works. Baldwin was not an adherent to what we today call identity politics. In examining his own personal feelings and observing those around him, he came to understand sexuality as being fluid, that his people could and should not be boxed or labeled by rigid concepts of homosexual or heterosexual. In this way, he echoed America's most important and influential sexologist of the 20th century, Alfred Kinsey, who shortly before, in 1948, shocked the nation with his study, Sexual Behavior in Human Male. In it, Kinsey shows that males do not represent two distinct populations, heterosexual and homosexual. Rather, sexual behavior and attractions fall along a continuum and can fluctuate over time. Baldwin never wavered in this belief, though in later years he gladly supported the gay liberation movement. Now for the plot, how the story unfolds. David, the novel's white narrator, is an American who's been living in Paris. He has a girlfriend named Hella, who's about to return from a trip to Spain to join him, and it's presumed they would then cement their plans for marriage. While in Paris, David hangs out at a gay bar, where one evening he meets a new bartender named Giovanni, a handsome Italian for whom David, despite his better judgment, begins to develop feelings. David, although when he was young, had once had a fling with a friend named Joey, sees himself as straight, so his attraction to Giovanni sets up a conflict within him. Giovanni begins to get passionately attached, but David, not being able to cope with his strong same-sex feelings for Giovanni, remains more reserved. The time they spend together in Giovanni's room is ecstatic for David, but also like a descent into hell, into having to confront feelings he's uncomfortable with and can't fully accept. When Hella returns, David realizes he has to break the news to Giovanni that his relationship with him is off. During their confrontation, Giovanni accuses David of deceiving him and being unable to love. From Giovanni's point of view, David is a typical American, clean cut, smelling of soap, but scared of risk of passion of life itself. After David breaks the relationship, he goes off with Hella to southern France, yet he remains concerned about Giovanni. He learns that his friend has lost his bartending job, along with his self-esteem, and is hanging out with a crowd of promiscuous and effeminate gay characters, both at once considered to be degenerates. David becomes increasingly aware that he may not really be in love any longer with Hella, who wants nothing more than their return to America and the normalcy of a traditional man-woman relationship. He disappears suddenly and goes in a binge of drinking and cruising anonymous men, where one evening Hella finds him. The bonds with her are irretrievably broken as Hella decides to return to America. Tragically, David learns that Giovanni, probably in an attempt to protect his honor, has murdered Guillaume, the bar owner who had once exploited and now fired him. The ending of the novel finds David, still in the south of France, awaiting news of Giovanni's impending execution by guillotine. We leave David in an ambiguous situation, but hopefully about to embark on a continuation of self-discovery and acceptance of himself for who he is. While Giovanni's Room is basically a love story, not all love stories are the same. This is hardly a boy meets girl, boy meets girl format. It is far more complex and nuanced. However, regardless of what race the characters are or their sexual preferences, there are universal truths here I believe we can all relate to. The major theme is the need for us to accept and love ourselves. We can't truly love others until we do. Otherwise, we remain unfulfilled in life, and we actually do harm to those around us, including the ones we love. As an illustration, let's take David, the novel's protagonist. In Giovanni's Room, he reminisces about his sexual liaison he had with his friend Joy when they were both young boys. The night they end up in bed together, David wakes up, realizes the consequences of what has just happened, and leaves the house in shame. Unable to deal with his feelings, he later joins with a group of boys who torment Joy. So here we have a typical homophobic pattern of behavior, the straight-identified person who can't deal with his homosexual feelings, projecting his fears, anger, and aggression onto others. Later, David's inability to fully acknowledge his homoerotic desires we find the beginning of the end for Giovanni. He's shattered at the loss of David and his dreams of a life together. He then demeans himself, the behavior he once despised, and eventually, in his desperation, commits an act of murder. The truths sold in Giovanni's room are timeless. The book is not dated, and its reputation as one of Baldwin's better novels only grows with time. Yet Giovanni's Room is a novel of its time. As you read it today, we might be taken aback by the extent to which its homosexually involved protagonists look down with disdain on effeminates and queens. More telling is the scene in which David and Giovanni confront each other before their breakup. Here, David finds it almost unimaginable to envision that two men might spend their lives together. Giovanni is pleading with David to leave Hella. David responds, "I can't have a life with you. What kind of life can we have in this room? What kind of life can two men have together anyway? You want to go out and be the big laborer and bring home the money? And you want me to stay here and wash the dishes and cook the food and lie with you at night and be your little girl? That's what you want." Giovanni responds, "I'm not trying to make you a little girl. If I wanted a little girl, I would be with a little girl. You know what I want. But I'm a man," David cries out, "a man. What do you think can happen between us?" Thankfully, the gay liberation and feminist movements helped answer this question in the late 60s, when they began to challenge gender and sex roles. And today, one can envision and even experience two men hooking up and freely experimenting, if they choose, with active and passive and masculine and feminine roles, or rejecting this polarity altogether, all without shame, stigma, or fear of arrest. I'd like to encourage you to experience Giovanni's Room for yourselves. It's a real page-turner. It's filled with drama and suspense and remarkable insights into human nature. There are themes I've not had time to mention you might want to explore, such as the juxtaposition of American and European sensibilities or the predicament of being a stranger in a foreign country. All the characters in the novel, by the way, are well drawn by Baldwin. They are never cardboard images. The hustlers and queens are individualized, and Ella undergoes much self-questioning about the role of a woman in society before she settles on her final decision to return to America and search out a traditional marriage. Baldwin's writing is lucid, at times even poetic, and I guarantee you'll find the book both an exciting and provocative read. Now, I'd just like to talk very briefly about the background for Giovanni's Room and provide a bit of an overview. Like most of Baldwin's works, inspiration came from real-life events. In the case of Giovanni's Room, it was a murder that took place in New York involving Lucien Carr, a brilliant young Columbia student, and a teacher named David Kammerer, who was obsessed with Carr and stalked him from city to city. After Carr killed Kammerer, Jack Kerouac and William Burroughs became involved. The case both fascinated and repelled Baldwin, and it's showing the willingness of a man to kill another when confronted with his touch. A 2013 movie titled Kill Your Darlings tells the story. An earlier version of Giovanni's Room had a heterosexual couple as protagonists, and earlier titles included One for My Baby, A Fable for Our Children, and Ignorant Armies. Baldwin also wanted to make Giovanni's Room, said to be his favorite book, into a play. The Actors Studio had developed a version of it, but Baldwin wasn't satisfied, so he undertook to write the play himself. The role of Giovanni would go to Engin Cezar, a young Turkish actor. For the role of David, Paul Newman, as well as Montgomery Clift and Marlon Brando were considered, all members of the Actors Studio as well. Finally, the studio did a workshop production in the spring of 1958 with Cezar and Mark Richmond in leading roles. It never made it into full-scale theater production, however. Later, Baldwin felt the play would have been a success if the studio had been able to provide a box office name to play the part of David. Brando had been too occupied with other endeavors to get involved, and many actors turned down the role of the homosexual David out of fear of it ruining their careers. Another project of Baldwin's, which interested him until his death, was making Giovanni's Room into a film. In 1978, he began a collaboration with Michael Rayburn, a Rhodesian director living in London. Marlon Brando had committed to playing the role of Guillaume, the bar owner where Giovanni worked. But negotiations went slowly, and in the end, money became an overriding issue, and the project had to be dropped. Today, the film version is a 411-page document, which if performed would take an estimated 5 hours. Interestingly, the final versions of the script had two major changes. First, there were a couple of incidental black characters, one a transvestite named Princess, and secondly, a speech by Giovanni, which can be said to reflect Baldwin's own feelings about gayness. Here, Giovanni speaks. "Chez Guillaume, they were always talking about gay liberation, but they are afraid to be free. That is why they always sound like a barnyard. Gay, they were always asking me. I say to them, it's nobody's business. Sometimes I am gay and sometimes I am sad. I do not have to join no club to love whoever I love. and I do not have to answer to nobody except just the good God who made me.
The next speakers will be Alicia and Reggie. But before that, I want to say that James Baldwin never, if he could help it, sign up or become a member of anything. After his experience with the church, he swore he wasn't. There were exceptions. One was the writers, the pen, because he felt if he was a member of that, he could get other black, young black writers that he liked. Toni Morrison, Maya Angelou, Calvin Brown. There were a number of black writers that he pushed. The other was the Actors Studio. He found out that they not only had dealt with actors, but they had workshops. So he had two of his plays produced there. Giovanni's Room and Blues for Mr. Charlie. After Blues for Mr. Charlie, Baldwin and the Actors Studio went their separate ways, and I'm sure Alicia or Reggie will go into details about that experience after the Blues for Mr. Charlie. It was a very controversial play for several reasons. I saw it about a week after it came out, and it was a very strange experience. The blacks was on one side, the whites was on the other, and there were certain speeches blacks would applaud. There were other speeches by Purnell and some of the others the whites would applaud. The only critic that said it was an excellent play was the New York Times. But enough said. Reggie, Alicia.
First of all, I want to thank everybody for coming out on this nice Saturday night. Mr. Baldwin, I was introduced to him during high school because my uncle. I'm sorry.
You want to get that?
Once again, thank you for coming out. I was introduced to Baldwin when I was in high school. And because my uncle was such a great fan, he made sure I became a great fan. So I've been reading his work for many, many years, and as I reread it, you know, sometimes it saddens me. Especially when you read Blues for Mr. Charlie. Blues for Mr. Charlie basically is a murder story. Someone gets killed. A young black man gets killed. And unfortunately, the same set of events that happened to Blues for Mr. Charlie happens today. As we delve into the work, you see that, you know, you could read this thing in the Post. Young black man is killed. The first thing they do, they talk about his drug history. Talk about the fact that he'd been incarcerated. They drag their feet about arresting the man. In fact, they make an appointment to arrest him. They don't kick his door in. They tell him, we'll be here Monday around 9. So, you know, with the Black Lives Matter situation going on right now, it's just like in the film. A lot, when he went back home, a lot of things are still happening. This particular work was staged in 1964. And as Jimmy just said, you know, the New York Times was the only paper that gave a favorable review. Most of the reviews were critical, They acknowledge it was an important work, but don't go see it.
Bobby,
I mean, Jimmy Wright was talking about the Actor's Studio and his relationship. And this is where we get back to seeing how defined Mr. Baldwin really was. You see, in putting on this play, he made certain demands to the Actor's Studio. First being that he wasn't going to get rid of all the cursing. You see, they felt that, you know, in those days, you know, and today also, people get dressed up, they go to the theater, they pay a lot of money. They don't want to hear this vulgar language. They don't want to be upset. They want to be entertained. These people, the producers, want to sell tickets. Baldwin felt that the message, if you're going to describe a black character, if you're going to have a truly original black character, you have to, the way they speak is the way they speak. The way they feel is the way they feel. We can't, you know, sugarcoat it just because it's Saturday night and you're with your wife. It just can't happen. So, you know, that was one problem. Another problem is that it's a three-act play. It's a very long play in terms of, you know, people actually sitting there and you have to, you know, two intermissions, you have to hold these people's attention. They felt that it was going to be too long. They wanted him to cut certain parts out to shorten it. He refused. Another thing is that you got to remember that Mr. Baldwin was always, you know, he realized he had many different audiences, okay? He had the young people. He had the church audience, which supported him throughout his whole career. And he had the black audience. And he had the regular, traditional Broadway audience. Now, in order to, you know, get everybody in there that he wanted to see the play, he had to cut the ticket prices. He had to make packages for the churches. Things had to be done to incorporate for everybody. Broadway producers didn't want to hear anything about that. They would have a ticket price for this particular seat, and anybody who wanted to sit in there gonna have to pay for it. So naturally, these demands were in conflict. And then, after the play came out, it was, like I said, it was critically acclaimed, but it wasn't pushed. It wasn't a must-go-see thing. And, you know, after that, there was a, you know, and I did a little research on this, and it seems like everything he wrote after that had shifted. He was a nice guy until Blues for Mr. Charlie came out. When Blues for Mr. Charlie came out, they started looking at him through a different lens. Either they felt he had changed, or either the way they looked at him had definitely changed. Now, Blues for Mr. Charlie had the traditional themes that Baldwin has. Baldwin always talks about the church, his volatile relationship with the church. He always talks somewhere in there about family relationships, like they did in the movie here. Did you see that? They went back and found his lineage, and they showed pictures of his father. His father died early, and he became, you know, the oldest, being the oldest son. So he felt that he was, you know, stepping into that vacuum. So it's always some tension about the father and son relationship, as it is in Blues for Mr. Charlie. It's always sexual tension. Not naturally, but as the play develops, in order to save her husband, the accused, the white wife, accused of the victim, Richard, of sexually, you know, trying to assault her. So it's always some sexual tension going on in Richard's past as they go back and forth to, you know, in the play. He, you know, describes his relationship with white women. It's always some sexual tension somewhere in the mix. Another very interesting thing that I remember the third time I read this play, but each time I read it, I see something else, and I see something else in Baldwin. I saw on YouTube about 2 weeks ago the debate between William F. Buckley and Baldwin. And Baldwin makes this point. He says, how despicable, he goes to the lineage, how despicable racism is. How it hurts black people or any oppressed people, wherever it is. But the real key is the insanity it brings to the oppressor. Mm-hmm. When someone mm-hmm. can continually, day after day, oppress people, beat them, jail them, you know, treat them unjustly, see that they're living in hard conditions, and they do nothing about it. They create this armor of righteousness that allows them to be comfortable doing what they do, and it's insanity. And this is the same thing that he's trying to portray in Blues for Mr. Charlie. The simple fact that the townspeople, knowing that this man had, first of all, killed someone else before and gotten away with it, and it was the unknown secret of the town, and then he'd done it again, and then for them to rally around him, he shows how insane the whole concept of racism is, and how it's just like a disease, and it's passed on from person to person. And that's one of his main things, and he put it together so cleverly here in Blues for Mr. Charlie, because he's using the people themselves by them justifying what they, well, he's not a bad guy, this, that, the other. But like I said, Blues for Mr. Charlie is a murder story. And it's a murder story that's continually happening as we speak. And this is what makes me sad when I read stuff like Blues for Mr. Charlie. This could be Ferguson. This could be any place in America right now. It's the same situation. So someone is murdered, and before you talk about the murderer, you talk about the victim. And another thing that you have to realize about Baldwin, and I've read so much about Baldwin, and he always throws it in the mix. He always talks about, he never lets anyone get away. Like Richard, the victim, is not a saint. He blatantly brings up his drug history. Not so much from the white man's point of view, but from Richard's point of view, and Richard's family, and how Richard's family feels about the fact that he was a drug addict. And, it's one of the good things about him. He doesn't, there's a lot of gray areas, and he expands them. He lets it, it's a lot of gray areas. Nobody's here is going to be just, sanctimonious about this or that. It's a lot of gray areas here, a lot of situations that have a lot of fingerprints on, and that's why I like his work. Let me see here. One thing that a piece of paper that I got, and I think that Kim just gave it to me, and I think it should be read if I can find it. Oh, here it is. And this is Baldwin speaking himself. First, like I was talking about, the family relationships. He says, "My family saved me, my brothers and sisters. I was the oldest and I was busy helping to care for them. I had no time to jump off the roof or become a junkie or an alcoholic. The welfare of my family has always driven me. They were the key to my will to succeed. They are my life." He also goes back and talks about his father. He goes, "With the death of my father, in my own mind, I was the father of my family. That's not quite the way they saw it, but I still was the oldest brother, and I took it very serious. I had to set an example." And on poverty, he writes, "We lived on Park Avenue, just above the Uptown Railroad tracks. The poverty of our childhood differed from the poverty of today. We were poor, and we knew we were poor, but then everybody around us was poor." You see, we live in a society right now where if Baldwin saw it, he would probably not be shocked, because he's the type of person that he said in this movie, it's not about being shocked or what you do. You have to confront it. You have to accept it. You have to take a look at it. And I think that today, I don't know what he would say, because we are not confronting it. We are not. I mean, things happen, and we live in this 24-hour news cycle. It seems like rather than do anything, it's more important to have the information. It's even better if there's an app for it. unfortunately, this is the situation. But Blues for Mr. Charlie, like I said, it's a play that just, like I say, it saddens me now. It doesn't move me to action. It saddens me because the same things are happening over and over and over again. And the same people are having the same attitudes over and over again. And unfortunately, this the situation that the dental folks in this play can unfold on any day. At the end of the play, it's typical, a guy gets off. The jury acquits him. It's not enough evidence. The person's character is more important than the evidence. Unfortunately, that's the times we live in.
Of course. Would you explain why Richard left the North and came South? And
well, actually, he came South because the North had beaten him. He was been arrested, he'd been locked up, he was hooked on drugs, and he actually came back South to get well. And he came back, when he came back South to get well, obviously, you know, Nick can never go home again. He was, you know, he was a, and this is why he had the conflict with Lyle and the people in town. Because he knew this was not right anymore. He's not a child anymore. And that resulted in the conflict that he had with the guy who eventually killed him.
And about his father, please.
Well, you see, that's another thing that kind of spoiling the whole play. But we do want you to read it. But you see, what happened was this. His mother was a domestic in a hotel. And she had, for what they say in the play, she was a good-looking woman. So she had problems with some of the people in the hotel. I guess some guys had hit her, some of the white men had hit on her. Anyway, she had a very terrible accident. Some people say she fell down some wet stairs. Some people say she was pushed down after she, you know, rejected somebody's advances. Anyway, she died. Instead of her, Richard's father, you know, mounting a big investigation and what happened to my wife or whatever, he he accepted it and turned to the church. And see, when we meet his father is the reverend of the church. So this whole thing with the church and their role in black lives, positive or negative, or how his father, as Richard sees it, was a coward and should have done something. As your wife is dead, you should have done something. And in fact, he did not tell Richard, and Richard found out. And so his father and him had this contentious relationship. Respectful, but contentious.
Thank you. There is one important female role in the play, Juanita. And she has relationships with everyone, all the men in the play, black and white. And Alicia's going to explain Juanita. And at the time, she was played by Diana Sands. It was one of her last good roles on Broadway.
Great actress. Great actress.
Yes, yes.
Okay. The character of Juanita in James Baldwin's Blues for Mr. Charlie serves several purposes. She gives us deeper insight into the character of Richard. She provides a watershed moment for Richard's character. She gives us insight into several other male characters as well. She provides a moral compass and a voice of reason and or a reality check for some of the male characters in the play. And she does give us some hope for the future. Juanita is in many ways a departure from a lot of the characters, the female characters that populate James Baldwin's novels. Oftentimes, his female characters are mothers or female love interests that have only one mission in life, and that is self-sacrificing themselves for their families. And Juanita is different. When we meet her, we learn that she isn't in any hurry to get married. She's a college student and an activist. She has had dreams of going north to study and become a lawyer. and to return to the sound of practice law. But she's conflicted because she realizes that she doesn't want to die in the South, and she's afraid of the South. We know that she is wise, perceptive, and confident. However, when she and Richard become reacquainted, her heart opens and she's in love for the first time. She becomes protective of him and wants to save him. In giving us a deeper insight into the character of Richard, Juanita and Richard used to hang out together when he lived in the South when he was younger. They were like the innocent little boyfriend and girlfriend, and she was more of a tomboy, and she would climb trees with him, and she was always hanging around him. And since she had this vantage point in her life with Richard, she could view him in a different way than some other people could. She had a unique insight into him. One of the first things she says to Richard when she sees him, when she meets him for the first time when he comes back to the South, she says, "Ain't you a mess? So you finally decided to come back here. Come, let me hug you." Although her mood is playful and welcoming, she knows instinctively that he is troubled. Juanita, Richard, and Pete hang out together in Papa D's juke joint the first night that he comes back and he meets her. And Richard starts to brag of his exploits in New York and all of the women that he has bedded, all of the white women that give him money, and they like having sex with him, and he's just bragging about his exploits with them. But Juanita is not shocked at all. She's not jealous, and she's not threatened by his exploits. She looks at him and says, "They sound very sad. It must be very sad for you too." So she knows that even though he's, you know, acting like he's the big guy, you know, and he's done so much more than everyone else, that he's really in pain and he's really hurting inside. When Richard begins showing pictures of the white women to them and to Papa D, Papa D tells him to put the pictures away. And Richard last commented that Papa D is scared of the man. And it's interesting to note that Richard did not put the pictures away until Juanita says, "Well, I'm not scared of the man, but there's no point in running around asking to be lynched." When Juanita and Richard begin talking alone at Papa D's after Papa D has left the table and after Pete has left the table, she asks him if he's all right. She knows she has heard that he has been sick, and she wants to find out what has happened to him and if he's okay. And he attempts to reassure her, "Yeah, I'm all right, I'm okay." But that doesn't stop her because she's not satisfied with that answer. She knows that there's more to it. She continues to ask him about his sickness. He tells her it wasn't serious and that he's better now, but she doesn't give in. She keeps chipping away at his defenses, and then he lets her in. He proceeds to tell her all about his life in New York, the real version, how hard he worked at his gigs, the shit he took from his managers, the fact that he couldn't stand the women he slept with, the loneliness and the pain he felt, how he turned to drugs to manage these feelings, and how he got hooked, how he got into trouble, lost all his possessions, got arrested, and landed in jail. He tells her, "Here I am, way down upon the Suwannee River, but I'm going to be all right. You can bet on it." And she tells him, "Well, I'd like to see that you will be all right." He's like, "How are you going to do that? You know, I won't let you go anywhere without me." He said, "You're still determined to break your neck. Well, it's a neck breaking time. I wouldn't like to appear to be above the battle." Richard says, "Do you have any idea of what you might be letting yourself in for?" Juanita says, "No, but you said you were lonely, and I'm lonely too." And that just kind of gives us a foreshadowing of, you know, something's coming. And Juanita provides a watershed moment for Richard's character. And it comes about when they spend their first night together and they have sex. And she's thinking about it on another day. This is like after he had already died, he had been killed. She got up in bed one morning and she said to herself, He lay beside me on that bed like a rock, as heavy as a rock, like he'd fallen from a high place, fallen so far and landed so heavy he seemed almost to be sinking out of sight, with one knee pointing to heaven. My God, he covered me like that. He wasn't at all like I thought he was. He fell on me like life and death. My God, his chest, his belly, the rising and the falling, the moans, how he clung, how he struggled, life and death, life and death. Why did it all seem to me like tears? That he came to me, clung to me, plunged into me, sobbing, howling, bleeding, somewhere inside his chest, his belly, and it all came out, came pouring out like tears. My God, the smell, the touch, the taste, the sound of anguish. Richard, why couldn't I have held you close? Yes, sir. Okay, then we find out later on what this experience with Juanita meant to Richard, when we find this out through her later on in the story. She says, by and by, Richard woke up and I was there, and we tried to make plans to go, but he said he wasn't going to run no more for white folks, never no more, but was going to stay and be a man right here. And I couldn't make him see differently. I knew what he meant. I knew how he felt, but I didn't want him to die. And by the time I persuaded him to take me away, from this terrible place, it was too late. Lyle killed him, like they've been killing all our men for years, for generations, our husbands, our fathers, our brothers, our sons. And Juanita also had a watershed moment, and she is explaining to Pete, another character in the story, what Richard's presence in her life meant to her and how he caused her to change. She said, when Richard came, he hit me in some place where I'd never been touched before. I don't mean just physically. He took all my attention. The deepest attention maybe that one person can give another. And she goes on, and then she says, it only lasted 4 or 5 days, Pete, 4 or 5 days, like a storm, like lightning. And what I saw during that storm, I'll always see. Before that, I thought I knew who I was, but now I know that there are more things in me than I'll ever understand. Juanita also gives us insight into other male characters. During the play, we learn that Meridian, who is Richard's father, Parnell, who is the white editor of the town newspaper, and Pete, which is a young student that Juanita's been going out with, have more than a passing interest or a passing feeling for Juanita. And because all three of these men, and plus Richard, have this attraction to Juanita, we come to realize that she must possess the qualities of a highly desirable maiden life. This desirability reaches far beyond mere looks, because we never really know what she looks like. We know that Lyle, the murderer, made an offhanded comment about her, about she's a pretty little nigger or something like that, but we don't give too much credence to what he said because he has these base instincts. The men who desire her to be in their lives, Meridian, Parnell, and Pete, seem to desire her for her character and her ability to bring something to their lives that is woefully absent. They seek some type of reassurance and or absolution. In the case of Meridian, Richard's father, after Richard's confrontation with Lyle, but before his murder, Meridian tells Juanita that they must send Richard away. He wants Juanita to go with Richard because he knows that they like each other. He takes this opportunity to present the feelings that he had for Juanita. And this is Juanita to him. Meridian, it's to Juanita. Juanita, tell me something. I have to know. I'll never ask it again. Yes, Meridian? before he came, I wasn't just making it all up, was I? There was something, at least beginning, something dimly possible, wasn't there? I thought about you so much, and it was so wonderful each time I saw you. And I started hoping, as I haven't let myself hope, oh, for a long time. I knew you were much younger, and I'd known you since you were a child, but I thought that maybe that didn't matter. After all, we got on so well together. I wasn't making it all up, was I? Oh, Anita says, no, you weren't making it up. Not all of it, anyway. There was something there. We were lonely. You were hoping. I was hoping, too. Oh, Meridian, of all the people on God's earth, I would rather die than hurt. Meridian says, hush, Anita. I know that. I just wanted to be told that I hadn't lost my mind. I lost so much. And throughout this story, you can see that all of these people, and especially the men, are dealing with so much loss and so much pain and so much emptiness. And somehow there's something in Juanita that brings them some type of solace or absolves them of some crimes that they feel that they've committed or something. And Parnell, the white editor of the paper, Juanita sees into Parnell because she's very perceptive. She sees into all of these people. She knows he's conflicted and tortured, and that because of who he is and where he lives, he makes the gestures but lacks the courage to take the high moral ground and do what he knows is the right thing to do. I think this was just after the funeral, and Juanita's coming out, and she looks at Parnell and says, what's the matter, Parnell? You look sick. I tried to come sooner. I couldn't get away. Lyle wouldn't let me go. Were you trying to beat a confession out of him? But you look as though he's been trying to beat a confession out of you. Poor Parnell. And then later on, the conversation changes, and he comes to a realization. He says, you loved him. Yes, I didn't know. Oh, you're so lucky, Parnell. I know you didn't know. Tell me, where do you live, Parnell? How can you not know all of the things you do not know? Why are you hitting out at me? I never thought you cared that much about me. But oh, Juanita, there are so many things I've never been able to say. There are so many things you've never been able to hear. And then later on, he says, are we friends, Juanita? Please say that we're friends. Friends is not exactly what you mean, Parnell. Tell the truth. Yes, I've always wanted more than that from you, but I was afraid you would misunderstand me, that you would feel that I was only trying to exploit you in another way. Juanita says, you've been a grown man for a long time now, Parnell. You ought to trust yourself more than that. I've been a grown man for too long, ever to have dared to dream of offering myself to you. Your age was never the question, Parnell. Was there ever any question at all? Yes, 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 once there was. And there isn't, there can't be anymore? No, that train is gone. And at one point later on, and she's the Juanita's, you know, reminiscent, talking to herself about these men in her life. And Richard has already died. And she says, what is this world like? I will end up taking care of some man someday. Help me do it with love. Pete, Meridian, Parnell, we have been the mothers for them all. It must be dreadful to be Parnell. Because just like Reggie said before, that James Baldwin knew that the racist also has their mental issues to deal with, and they're also very, very sick. And she recognizes that Parnell. And Pete, after Richard's death, Pete confronts Juanita and asks why she won't turn to him now that Richard is gone. Why have you been avoiding me? Don't answer that. You started going away from me as soon as Richard came to this town. Now listen, Richard's dead, but you still won't turn to me. I don't want to ask you for more than you can give, but why have you locked me out? I know you liked me. We had nice times together. We did. I do like you, Pete. I don't know. I wish you wouldn't ask me now. I wish nobody would ask me for anything. And Pete goes on to say, I need you. I'll be faithful. That helps. You'll see. And Juanita says, so many people need so much. And I think that's the way she felt, that everybody needed something from her. You know, she was willing to give it to Richard, but everyone else needed the same thing from her. But Juanita is not hopeless, and she'll move on with her life. And she tells Parnell, one day I'll recover. I'm sure that I'll recover, and I'll see the world again, the marvelous world, and I'll have learned from Richard how to love. I must. I can't let him die for nothing. And at one point, when she's having a monologue, you know, she and Richard did have sex, and she says, Mama's afraid I'm pregnant. Mama is afraid of so much. I'm not afraid. I hope I'm pregnant. I hope I am. One more illegitimate black baby. That's right, you jive mothers. And I'm going to raise my baby to be a man. A man. You dig?
Blues for Mr. Charlie, because of his making them reduce greatly the amount, did not make it on Broadway. But it's one of his most reproduced plays. And it has been to Israel, France, England, South America, and the black companies in the United States have revived it numerous times. And it was one of his favorite plays. He based it on the Emmett Till case, and he also based it on a friend of his who was a musician who became a drug addict. What is his name? Arthur? Help me. Is this Arthur? Okay. Who was a drug addict here in New York, and he had to go south. Baldwin tried to save him a couple of times by putting him into rehab. But the environment, that jazz environment, he wasn't able to deal with without the drugs. He went south and he disappeared. No one knows, well, I'm sure someone knows, but the people here in New York, his friends and Baldwin, do not know what happened to him. He was sending cards and letters once in a while, and then everything stopped. Before I read the biographical information about Baldwin, I want to discuss the most important person in his life, his mother. She was the one person he could take criticism from, other than his brother David. He had a number of writings that he had finished, but said they cannot be done until Mother Baldwin is dead. He always was worried about her reaction, especially Giovanni's room. He was very worried about her reaction. He was worried about her reaction on Blues for Mr. Charlie, because there was so many motherfuckers, nigger, and such in it. And she was a very, very much a church woman. She always supported him, even with his stepfather. Some of his siblings were a little upset of the treatment in his novels about their father. And she supported him completely. I want you to read some comments that he says about his mother.
You can't leave.
Growing up, we thought she was very fragile, too gentle, too forgiving, but she was very strong. To raise 9 children under those circumstances, she had to be. I think she saved us. She was the only person in the world we could turn to. Yet she couldn't protect us from those streets. She must have been scared to death all the years she was raising us. My mother told us often, "You have lots of brothers and sisters. You don't know what's going to happen to them. So you're to treat everybody like your brothers and sisters."
Thank you. James Baldwin was born August the 2nd, 1924, in Harlem Hospital, New York City, to Emma Jones, father unknown. He died before she gave birth, either suicide or murder. 2 years later, his mother married David Baldwin, a minister from Louisiana, almost twice her age. He adopted James, and they had 8 children, 5 girls and 3 boys. He also had 2 sons in Louisiana, whom he abandoned. Baldwin attended PS 24 in Harlem and Junior High School 139 in Harlem. One of his teachers was the poet County Carlin. He also attended, at that time, the elite all-boys high school in the Bronx, DeWitt Clinton. He graduated in 1942. At the age of 14, Baldwin became a boy minister, and he remained a boy minister for 3 years. It was the church was Fireside Pentecostal Assembly Church in Harlem, and that's where he got the idea for the Amen Corner. He used his minister, who was a female, and he used her son. His ideas always came from something in his life.